Welcome to Biscontv Life. On this show, we give you a fine blend of everything, ranging from music, sports, business tips, real life talk, and a little bit of gossip. I am your host, Emma Charles, and I'm going to be sharing my thoughts, views, and opinions on various segments of the show. But I'm not going to be doing this alone today. I have two amazing personalities with me today on the show. I have Precious and I have Ibilola. How are you today?
I'm fine.
I love the way you just put on your smile. Are you excited?
Yeah.
You ready? Okay, so on today's episode, we're going to be discussing the usual. That is the Biscon Top 3, the Versus Show, Ladies Lane, and Biscon Profiling. But before we do that, we're going to go on a quick break, and when we come back, we'll be here to talk and gist. So don't go anywhere. Back, and if you're just joining us, we're starting with the Biscon Top 3. So today we're going to be doing a little bit of intimacy. We're going to be talking about life experiences down to Ladies Lane, from the top 3 to Versus Show and all of that. So we're going to be doing, you know, you're going to get to know a little bit about us. So on the top 3, we're going to talk about, the pick is going to be, you know, your favorite childhood memory. What's one thing that you remember doing in your childhood? Maybe you may be happy, maybe sad, whatever it is, just let us know. So I'll start with you, Precious.
Okay, my mom told me something. She said, as a little girl, I was very bold. So I think then I was about 3-4. So I went to, she was selling things in a market. So she would keep me at my cousin's place. So that day I came, I was wearing a big slippers, an oversized. So the auntie called me, I was like, Adaku, remove that slipper, remove that slippers. I just turned. Okay, I'm going to speak Igbo because I actually spoke Igbo then. And I turned, I was like, Shepa Shani Obuntei Obuntei Obunkumugo. It means this slippers I'm wearing, it doesn't belong to you. Is it not Mugo's? She is Ugo. I'm telling her it's for her mother.
Yes.
Not so why are you dragging it with me? And I sighed and I walked out. So it's something that they don't seem to forget. Each time I go there, she'll be like, Adaku, Shepa Sha, Shepa Sha. So he always, like, it means a lot to me. So
okay, and what song, you know, since it's Wednesday, we're going to do our WCW, that's Wednesday Crush Woman. Okay. What song from a Nigerian artist?
Okay, female artist. I think I love Yemi Alade. She's very African, and her style and her whole, you understand, gidiwa gidiwa.
Yeah.
So I like Johnny.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Okay. Me holiday, it's a spicy baby. Johnny leave me follow Cynthia, and I don't know what to do. And he talk say I no do am like the way Cynthia they do. Johnny give you chebele, he talk say he want marry Nene. Walk him kedi feneme. Johnny mo, Johnny mo, I'm looking for my Johnny. If I know see my Johnny, I'm looking for my Johnny, I'm looking for my honey. You're telling me this, you're telling me that, I say this is not for me. Johnny do me corny, Johnny do me corny. He's doing me this, he's doing me that, but I know what tell mommy. He go Canada, he go Tokyo, yesterday he say he de Morocco. He dance the sicko, he sing a willow, na lie, na lie, na Pinocchio. This one I go be. Original go away. See me, see what I like. Johnny leave me follow Cynthia, and I don't know what to do. And he talk say I no do am like the way Cynthia they do. Johnny give you chebele, he talk say he want marry Nene. Walk him kedi fenene. Johnny mo, Johnny mo. And what's your one favorite childhood memory that you know would like to share with us today?
Well, I don't think I really have any favorite childhood memories, but I would like to share, well, the fact that when I was younger, my mom says, she always says it, that I used to be a prophetess. Like, like anything I say
used to come to pass.
Yes, so that's the only thing I love about my childhood.
And what song But before we go to the song, do you remember actually prophesying into anybody's life?
Oh, yes. A couple of people's lives. In fact, I had enemies when I was growing up. Sorry.
Wow.
Because my mom used to tell me to bridle my tongue. Mm. I used to curse a lot when I was growing up. I was very stubborn. Forget that I'm calm now.
So when did you stop, you know, seeing visions and prophesying?
I didn't stop seeing visions and prophesying. I still do.
Wow.
Yes, but it's not as strong as it used to be before. But when I go into my sober mood or something like that.
I hope one day you see for me and Precious. I'm living here for good. Nigeria.
Yeah.
So yeah, and what song from a Nigerian female artist would you like to share with us today?
Oh, my song. Goroba.
So that's Goroba by Tiwa Savage. Yes. Childhood memory that, you know, I would love to share today is when at the beginning of a term one of my aunties invited me to come stay with her for summer, and you know, my mom was like, girl, you cannot go anywhere if you don't have this percentage. I think at that time it was like 70. No, it was 70. She said I needed to have 70 overall, and I was getting like 60 something percent. And then at the end of the term, I knew I was supposed to travel the next week. I told my mom that, so I got my report sheet, because you know they'll give you and then you go home with it. So I got my report sheet and it was 60 something, and then I turned the 6 to 8, added one curve like this, added another curve like this. She's like, oh my god, wow, you really got 80 something. You also, oh no, you're going. And she bought me so many things. And when I traveled, and then I came back like 3 months later, I told her about it. She just looked at me and laughed. So I felt like since that day, she started checking well, because it was clean. It was really clean. Wow. And my song of the day. I know, I'm sorry. I really wanted to go.
I think she really trusted you, because my kind of person, even when I see it's something, I'll start looking at, like, for physics.
I was really young. One, I was really young, and she never thought I would do something like that. But I really just wanted to travel. Like, you could not stop me. At that point, it was what I needed to do. Mm. And the funny thing, now that I've grown up, I know that she'd have still allowed me to travel even if I had not gotten that percentage. But because I was younger, I didn't have sense. I had to do it anyway. Style. So, and the song of today for me is definitely going to be See Me. I love how she, you know, injects a little bit of humor while still showcasing her talent. And it will definitely be Jam Question by See Me.
I like Jam Question.
Yes.
Question. Haven't met you before.
over to the rest of the show where we have a very funny and laid-back question. And there's only one rule on the rest of the show, which is to pick an option. You don't get to sit on the fence. So I'm going to start with Ibilola today. And the question is, would you rather have hands instead of feet or feet instead of hands if you had just one option?
That's really hard.
Yeah, it is.
Okay. I would rather have hands instead of feet, because if I have my hands, I'll be able to pick something, stick, you know, wash plates, wash clothes.
How do you get to the sink?
Well, there are ways to do things now. So, I'd rather have hands. I don't know.
Okay, no problem. Precious, what are you? What would you rather have?
Okay, I don't know, but at least on the streets, we see some of these, some are not beggars, but you see some people who are amputated. They either use this stuff they used to sit on the road and roll, or they use wheelchairs and all of that. So I think I'll go with hands. I'll have hands.
I think I'd rather have hands too, because, I mean, we also have automated cars now for people, you know. But there's really no way you can drive without having hands. And there's so many things you can do with your hands that you cannot do with just feet. I feel feet is limited just for movements and, you know. But with hands, what if you have feet and you need to slap something on your back, or you need to hold a child from falling? You know? I don't know. I mean, thank God we have the option of both. We thank God.
But there are still people who have feet and don't have hands.
And they're making it work. Yeah, but I just, you know, we've not experienced it. I just feel it to be easier, because how do you drive?
Not just driving.
How do you cook? How do you carry things?
Don't even scratch your head. Have you ever scratched your head?
It's because you have the option, though. If you never had the option, you'd find ways around it. So now we're going to go over to Ladies Lane. And like I said before, this episode is one that is very intimate. It's going to be very interactive about personal stories and our personal lives. I hope you enjoy it. So we have, you know, a very interesting topic / question today. But before we do that, we'll also have to go on a break. And when we come back, we'll be here to continue the discussion.
Do you want to mend the broken pieces of your heart? Do you want to make a change but don't know where to start? Hop on the train of love. Let's go on a journey. Trying something new. Talking relationships. Getting down to the thick of it. Let's go on the road to finding you. With Keep It Special, your number one love program. Love is in the air. Let's catch some of it.
Welcome back. This is Ladies Lane, and I'm going to start with a tweet that I saw on Twitter the other day. So this girl says, I feel stupid, but I'll be fine. A friend told me about having heart disease and that she had just a few months to live if she doesn't go in for an operation. When she called me and told me about it, I was angry because she kept on talking about dying and all. I told her to shut up and stop talking like that, and went ahead to ask her how much was needed for this surgery. She told me 3 million. At first, I was like, okay. And asked her again, how much do you have already? She said, and I quote, some millions. You can help me with anything. As a good Samaritan that I am, I gave her 1 million naira because I need my friend alive now. I'd be who wouldn't, especially when you know you can help. Only for her mom to innocently call me to ask about my dad. That was how I got to find out that my so-called friend, who had just a few months to live, lied to me. She lied to me. Her mother said, and I quote, Holy Ghost fire, my picking day okay, will she even travel? Mama, no be Holy Ghost fire, tell me, say, she's sick, oh, na your daughter. So I gave her 1 week to pay me my money back, or I'd have her arrested. I hate this side of me. Maybe a little bit of wickedness will do. I feel so stupid, I just needed to vent. So now, to the topic of the day. You know, what's an unforgivable lie you've ever been told, and how did you get past it? You know, as human beings, we try to trust people. If you don't trust people, what's the point of friendship? What's the point of any relationship, regardless if it's sexual or not? Just friendships, even family. Yeah. But then people tend to break that every time you decide to be a good person. And that's when people say, wickedness pays. But you know, at some point or the other, you just have to be a good person to one person and hope that they don't break that trust that you have. So I'll start with you, Precious. What lie, what unforgivable lie have you ever been told?
Okay, I don't know if I'll call this a lie, but when I was in school, I used to have a best friend. Mm-hmm. We're pretty close. Then, you know, along the line, I met this young man. He was, you know, then in school, I think I was in 200 level. So I met him and he was wealthy. In fact, then I had never met someone that rich. He was rich. So I was, I don't know, I was flabbergasted. I was so happy. I was like, baby, I have lots of money. I'm even scared. Mm. I don't deserve this kind of person. And she's like, are you serious? Leave all these rich people. You know, she was, you know, those kind of people. And she was talking down. I was like, okay. So on a certain day, he wanted to take me. I was like, okay. Can I come with my friend? I don't want to go alone. My friend was older than me. She was my bestie. And I took her along. And, you know, I was so free that I allowed them, you know, exchange contact and all of that. Before you know it, I don't know what she was telling me, but he just changed. And I was wondering. I didn't know that behind my back, she started seeing him. And it reduced our communication flow. It was later, maybe after he had sex, because we hadn't done anything. And next thing, he was like, you know what? I'm relocating. He was to leave when Umuahia. So he was leaving Umuahia for another state. And he's like, okay, I'm leaving Umuahia. I'm relocating. But I want to tell you something. Your friend is not a good person. And he sent me everything they've, you know, discussed. It was heartbreaking. Mm-hmm. It's not a lie, but it was deep. Till tomorrow, she doesn't even know that I know.
So how did you get past it?
I just had to cut off the friendship. I talked to her, but every time I see her, I always remember that she made me lose that person. Because now he was in between believing the things she had said or doubting. But either ways, he just didn't want any of us. So he had to just move.
Yeah.
So it was, for me, it broke my heart. But that friendship,
I like the way you handled the cutting off. I mean, that is very mature of you. But also, if I can add something, I would say that, you know, it takes two to tango in this situation. You know, it wasn't just the girl. He could have approached you. Hey, look what your friend is saying. I think you should be wary of this friend. She actually isn't your friend. Not after things has gotten physical and then you come back and tell me your friend is not good.
Because I think he was being a man. Men who just want to, those kind of men who just want to have a pound of flesh. So
yeah.
He enjoyed himself.
Yeah.
But I'm glad
that he still told you that.
Yeah. And we had to. So both of them had to.
Yeah. Yeah. And you, Ibilola.
I think something like that had happened to me before. I decided to forgive the girl. You know, I was in school then and I introduced. Okay, I went to the guy's house with my friend. And before you knew it, they started dating. I didn't know. And one day I was coming back from school and I saw my friend come out of his gate and I was like, what's she looking for in his house?
Mm.
My boyfriend's house. And then when I confronted him, it was like another story. And that friendship, well, it's not over, but I would say it's not the same again like before. I had to forgive and forget as the calm person that I am now. But that doesn't mean I'm a mumu. But the one that is even more painful. Let me sit well first. There was this guy who, that he was okay, we were friends for a couple of years, and along the line he asked me out. I was surprised. I was like, okay, he's a pastor. I was surprised. I was like, oh, maybe he's the will of God for me. But one thing I forgot to do was to pray about it. Because in any relationship you go into, you need to seek the face of God first.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, then I decided to, I wasn't in love with him. I just liked him as a friend, like a bestie. I wasn't in love with him. Yes.
Okay.
Yes, now, why are you looking at me like that? So, along the line, I agreed to be his girlfriend. And we started going for like a month. And I discovered that anything he posts on Facebook, there's this particular girl that will comment, either with an emoji or something. So I decided one day, the devil in me decided to check the girl's Facebook page. So I went to her Facebook page and checked, and I saw this guy, my boyfriend though. I saw him, he proposed to the girl, like pictures of him and the girl all over her page. She was bearing his name. In fact, they were already even secretly married. I was like, God, I was shocked. So I'm this kind of person that when I discover, when I find out about something, it doesn't surprise me anymore because of the experiences I've had in the past, especially with girlfriends. So when I confronted him later, he started lying to me, and that really got to me. It really made me angry. And you were still asking me out, you were even telling me to marry you, proposing to me and all that. And I was like, why would my friend, like someone I call my best friend, do something like
your
this?
Boyfriend?
No, he used to be my best friend before becoming my boyfriend.
But in this situation, because you're in a relationship, because you're best friend, he doesn't necessarily have to admit to anything. I mean, right? But he owes you an explanation, yes, because you're in a relationship,
yes,
with him.
Yes.
Do you understand? It's like both of us being best friends now and me getting engaged to somebody, right? Even though I'm supposed to tell you, I do not owe you an obligation, right? But if I am your girlfriend somewhere else, you have to tell me that.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, so.
Okay, so I went, I was so angry that I had to go to a TV station to rant about it. Yes, I hid my identity. That was how I got past it. So each time I remember, I go back, because it's on Instagram, I go back and listen to it, and I just laugh.
Okay.
Thank God for groups, dude. Yeah, you want to say something else?
Yeah.
You can add another story.
Okay, I think that was 2015, my final year. So I was in a relationship with someone, and it was December. His brother had come in from Turkey, I think so, yeah. So normally, that was on the 25th, my mom is very welcoming.
Mm.
Yeah, and she likes people that have cars. I don't know how to put, but that's the kind of thing she likes.
That's
so
true.
When I told her, one of my friends was like, "Oh, now you have one motor." I was like, "Yeah." So I said, "Okay, yeah, be an in now." So she made food, and he came with, you know, his brother, and he came and served there, and everybody ate. So after they finished eating, he was like, he's going to his own place. You understand? He has not seen mom in a while. He will be traveling, and we'll keep talking. I was like, "I'll miss you and all of that," and he left. He left though. Normally, he called me that night in the morning. I was at my mom's shop helping her out with some things, and I called him. When I called, he was like, "We're just talking." And next thing, I was like, "Baby, I'll call you back. I'll call you back. I want to." My mom said, "Come and sweep the parlor." He's 32. I said, "Then," and I'm like, "Sorry, he just called." I started thinking in my head. I was like, "Your mom said, come and sweep the parlor," and that's
running.
Why I dropping the call.
Mm-hmm.
Cause even me, at the age I was then, even if my mom says, "Adaku, come and sweep the parlor," tell mommy, "Wait, I'm making call."
Mm-hmm.
Do you understand? I wouldn't even run off like that. So I was disturbed. You know, when you like someone, there's this instinct, there's this.
Mm-hmm.
I wasn't satisfied, so I just ran in, put on a bomb shirt, wore a polo. I remember picking 200 naira, put that back of my pocket, crossed the mirror, took keke straight to his house. I don't know. My mind just said I should go there.
Mm-hmm.
So when I went there, I just got to the gate. As I opened, see his car parked there, I was like, "Ah, I thought they were supposed to be in the village." And I spoke with
Wait, where did you go back to?
Straight to his house.
No, where is his house, or where was his house then?
His own house in Uma here.
Okay, and where was his village?
His village is in Imo State.
Oh, okay.
So
okay.
I saw the car in the compound. I was like, I thought this person said he traveled. Well, but that was where my mind said I should go to. So I got there, I saw the car, I didn't talk. I saw a lady, she was in front of their door washing. So I greeted, I was like, "Hey, good afternoon, my name is Precious. I stay upstairs." So she was like, "Oh, okay, I came to visit my boyfriend." I was like, "Who's your boyfriend?" She called his name, George. She's like, "George." I was like, "Okay. Hey, are you serious? I've not seen your face before. Since when?" Like, "Oh, we've been dating for a year now. So I just came for the Christmas holidays."
Mm.
I'm like, "Oh, okay. Are you helping him wash?" I've really never washed for him though. So she was like, yeah, I just want to." I said, "Okay, is he inside?" She said, "Yes." I said, "Let me go and greet him." She said, "Okay, he's in." So I opened the door, and you have to walk through the parlor straight to the room. So I just walked. As I knocked on the room door, he was even shouting, "Baby," he thought it was a girl. He just opened the door. It was me. So he was like, "Hey, babe." And I didn't even say another one. Like, I'm sure he felt like the ground should open so that he would just get in. I just looked at him. I closed the door and I went off. And this is someone that, you know, he was with my mom just yesterday.
I know how
mothers are. Next thing they're going to start asking, what about that young man that came yesterday? And here, you know, we've had many plans, like, you know, I think, you know, Igbo men sometimes they'll be like, you should get pregnant first and all of those things. If not that, I know where I come from. Maybe I would have actually given in, you know. When I walked out of that place, I was crying. Like, I'm so emotional. So on the way, I was just like, oh my God. I was crying and I was just walking home. But in my head, I was thinking of many things I would do that would pain him. Should I go back and burn his car? Should I scatter the house? Should I do this? Should I go and fight the girl? I was thinking, but I was just going. I took another cake, I went home. I didn't eat for 3 days. Then my mom would come. My mom is very sarcastic. I just come, ha. Did your mom break your heart? She will make all those kind of comments and I'll be like, mommy, leave me alone. She will come again. She will say another thing. And one day I just made up my cousin. I had even lost the big phone I was using and he was supposed to get me a phone. I was like, if I end this relationship now, I will not get this phone. The phone that was running there was Q5. I think, yeah, Q10.
Blackberry
Q10. So that was what was raining. It was for big girls and he was supposed to get me that phone. I was like, if I end this relationship now, I won't get this Q10. I need this phone. So I just locked up. He called like 3 days later. I was like, I'm so sorry. You know, he was explaining. I said, no problem. We started talking. I was like, what of the phone? He said, no problem. He'll get me the phone that weekend. That weekend, he came out to my side, drove me to a shop, one telecommunication shop in Abia State. And we went. I picked my Q10 and I went home. You know, like, I go home. I sent him a text message and told him, I'm done. I like a true Igbo queen.
I don't forget to add that this guy I was talking about sent me some money, like to the extent that he could go. He sent me like almost 100k, and I was like, so I was surprised. I was shocked. Like,
in the end, he was lying about.
He was just lying about everything.
Well, for me, I've never really had problem with girlfriends, like female friends, because I am very, I don't want to say this like to show up anything, but I'm very selective about people I call my friend, and I'm also very particular about people I let into my life. So once I see that, if you say things like from the onset, if we're talking, because I'm very friendly, so maybe you say something like, oh, I could just beat that girl, I already know you cannot be my friend because you're aggressive. Now, if from stories of other people, of how you relate with other people, oh yeah, this girl's boyfriend texted me and I texted back, blah, blah, blah. I already know we cannot be friends. So I'm very particular about people in my life, and I think I haven't had any problems till now. But also, if I'm in a friendship with somebody, and let's say like your own situation where I go out to the person to see a guy and I realize that you have the boy's number behind my back, I'll throw both of you aside. Do you understand? Because one, there's no need continuing that relationship or that friendship. Person could just keep on hurting you because you asked my boyfriend, why did you not tell me that I got your friend's number? If you're actually very open, if you did not have any ulterior motive, why didn't you tell me that? Or you asked my friend, if you're actually just checking out for me, there's no problem my friend having my boyfriend's number. I don't think it's a problem. But not you hiding it and me finding out behind your back that you went to collect, behind my back that you went to collect somebody's number. So with that, I'll let you go. But also, maybe I've just been lucky. Because you never know, people can, you know, act like they're actually good, and there's a little, anyway, at the end of the day, there's a little bit of devil inside of us, you know, there's a little bit of blackness, and some people are just very, very
mean,
strong at holding that part of them down. Some people at some point or other will let it out. But when it comes to men, I would say the big, most unforgivable lie, I mean, we all know that the opposite gender lies a lot. No, they lie. But, and at some point, I mean, I even got so used to that if somebody lies to me, like a guy or a man lies to me, I would just say, oh, that was not good. You can't do better. Another lie. That's the type of person I am.
Okay.
But with this guy, I was in school. I think I was in my third year or something like that. And I had friends. I had a lot of male friends, not boyfriends, a lot of friends. And I knew that, you know, most of them just wanted to get physical with the girls that they were with. Some of them were protective of me too as well, but I knew the kind of guys, and you know, they have a term that we cannot pronounce on air, but you know those boys. And you know, I met this guy, he was almost going to turn 30, and at that time I think I was like 20. So you know, we started talking, all of that. He was very religious, now. And the thing about religious guys is that you expect so much more from them. Mm-hmm. Like if you're with somebody that is wild and blah blah blah, you tend to expect those kind of things, like, oh, he will lie to me. But with those religious guys, especially the ones that even judge other people that are religious and say, oh, this person that goes to this church, if you see what he does with other girls and stuff like that, so he expects this from him. So, you know, he was asking me for a relationship and all of that, and at that time, it wasn't what I wanted. But I also still knew that I needed companionship at that time, but I did not want a relationship. So, you know, we're seeing how things were going, and he would casually talk about his ex. And I don't have a problem talking about exes. You know, some people, they're like, don't talk about your exes. I don't have a problem. So we'll talk about it. And I would even advise him, oh, I know you're still talking to this girl. And all of that. But to cut the long story short, I later found out that the ex was still his girlfriend. Oh. Right? Yeah. And literally, he was just asking me for relationship advice. Do you get? And when I confronted him, about it, he said, oh, I didn't tell a lie. I just held back some part of truth. From me. Like that line,
that was psychological.
I know, like, did you really think I was, if I was dumb, I honestly think that maybe he thought that he could get away with it. I just held some parts of truth from you because I didn't want to hurt you. I did not lie. And it was till today, I could never get past that lie. I just could not. Why didn't you tell me? That was my point. Like, why did you not tell me? I have friends that do this all the time. I expected more from you. Why did you not tell me? And the only thing I did was stopped replying his messages. He came to my house to beg in school then and all of that. But I mean, he'd always try to check up and all of all the random hi hellos, but nah, I'm not that type of person. I don't like to keep communication with people that hurt me. No offense. In that light. I mean, there's little but that was too much for me. Because if you can do that, you can definitely do other things in the relationship. But yeah, this was fun to share. I love that you guys shared your experiences. We're all humans and this is something we experience on a day-to-day life. So that's it for today on Ladies Lane. Now we're going to look at our Black Queen's profile of the day.
Welcome to Black Queen Profiling. Our Black Queen today is Michelle Robinson Obama. Michelle was born on January 17, 1964. She is an American attorney and author who was the First Lady of the United States from year 2009 to 2017. She's married to the 44th President of the United States, Barack Obama. She was the first African American First Lady. Raised on the south side of Chicago, Illinois, Obama is a graduate of the Princeton University and Harvard Law School. In her early legal career, she worked at a law firm called Sidley Austin, where she met Barack Obama. She subsequently worked in a nonprofit organization as the Associate Dean of Student Services at the University of Chicago, as well as the Vice President of Community and External Affairs of the University of Chicago Medical Center. Michelle married Barack in the year 1992, and they have two daughters. Michelle campaigned for her husband's presidential bid throughout 2007 and 2008, delivering a keynote address at the 2008 Democratic National Convention. She has subsequently delivered acclaimed speeches at the 2012, 2016, and 2020 conventions. As the First Lady, Michelle served as a role model for women, and she worked as an advocate for poverty awareness, education, nutrition, physical activity, and healthy eating. She supported American designers and is considered a fashion icon. And that's our Black Queen for today.
Welcome to Did You Know segment. Did you know the color which we see when we close our eye is called eigengrau, which is different from color black? also on Did You Know segment. Did you know that this is where we get chocolates from? It is cocoa pods that gives us cocoa beans, which is fermented, dried, cleansed and roasted before being grounded into cocoa mass, the unadulterated form of chocolate. And finally, on Did You Know segments. Did you know the longest name placed on Earth is located in New Zealand, having 85 letters in total?
So our time is past spence, and this is where we end it on today's episode of Biscontv Live. I hope you enjoyed this episode as much as we did, and I can't wait to meet you on the next episode. Bye for now.